All right, welcome to the final session of our conference. A big thanks to all of you for being here and those that have attended throughout, especially our panelists. I know that this is the culmination of not just a lot of hard work, but a lot of hopes from a lot of people to be able to gather together and talk about what we feel are some very important things. So for this panel, it's race at the ward level, which we hope will be some more street-level actionable items and explanations. The format will be I will deliver a presentation from an ethnography of sorts that I've put together that all of the panelists have seen in advance. So they got the long version. You guys get the short version because nobody wants to hear me talk about all those pages. President Sullivan said he didn't really want to read all those pages either. He made it, though. To introduce the panelists that we have, Jermaine Sullivan was born in Tuscaloosa, Alabama. He's the youngest of seven children born to Mary and James Sullivan. He joined the church in Tuscaloosa on June 27, 1999, after seeing a Lamb of God video advertisement. I will note that he shortly then moved to Atlanta at the same time that I went to Atlanta, and we both met our future wives in the same ward. He immediately called a number on the screen, and 2 days later, the missionaries delivered the video and began to teach him the gospel. When he moved to Atlanta, Georgia, a month later, he met his wife, Kembe. A few months after dating, she asked him if he would be interested in serving a full-time mission for the church. He prayed about it and received very clear instruction from the Lord that he should serve. Jermaine served in the Brazil Fortaleza mission from November 2000 to 2002. Jermaine earned a Bachelor of Arts degree from Georgia State University and a Master of Education in Higher Education Administration from Georgia Southern. He currently works in online higher education administration at Clayton State University, where he develops and implements advising services for online students. Janan Graham Russell is a writer, graduate student in religious studies at the Howard University School of Divinity, community organizer and active member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. Her research and writing focus on Africana women in the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, womanist theology, and I don't know that word. What's it? Hermeneutic, yeah, it's, my mouth is not used to that one, so. But I can say, as well as spiritual narratives of African-American women in the 19th century. As an activist, her work draws attention to the misrecognition of black women within and outside the LDS faith tradition and culture. She currently writes for Rational Faiths, an online publication that features pieces about the LDS church, theology, and culture. Her writing is also featured in two forthcoming anthologies, A Book of Mormon, Latter-day Saints on Modern-Day Zion, I Speak for Myself, and Mormon Feminism, Essential Writings, November 2015. Dr. Peter Johnson is the Ernst & Young Fellow and Assistant Professor of Accounting in the Culverhouse School of Accountancy at the University of Alabama. He received his PhD in Accounting from Arizona State University and his Master's degree of Accountancy from Southern Utah University. Dr. Johnson teaches intermediate and advanced financial accounting and serves as a member of the Curriculum Assessment Committee for the School of Accountancy. Since 2013, he has served as a stake president over the Bessemer, Alabama stake, where he became the first black stake president in Alabama. He joined the LDS Church in 1986 at the age of 19 after converting from the Nation of Islam. Ms. Ingrid Shepard is the executive director of the One Less Foundation, a nonprofit organization headquartered in Philadelphia, with a mission to alleviate poverty by providing financial literacy, one-on-one mentoring to adults and youth, and supplemental education programs to schools. Prior to founding the One Less Foundation, Ms. Shepard worked as a consultant through her firm, Shepard Consultancy, LLC, providing advisory services to the federal government and financial institutions on matters related to U.S. anti-money laundering laws and regulatory and compliance issues. Ms. Shepard's professional experience includes employment at Merrill Lynch and the Bank of New York, specializing in legal compliance and international taxation. Ms. Shepard has also worked as a tax associate at Ernst & Young, Global Tax Network, specializing in expatriate taxes. Ms. Shepard was born and raised in Denver, Colorado, moved to Philadelphia in 2002, where she currently resides. Ms. Shepard attended Texas A&M University. She is a member of the board of directors of the Germantown Special Services District, and Municipal Authority. She is a lifelong member of the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints, where she has held callings, assignments, including Relief Society President, Stake Relief Society Counselor, Ward Employment Specialist, and Primary Teacher. That's our cast of characters. What I want to begin with is to frame my discussion and how I will be presenting it. I want to explain it that the document they received was a little bit of an ethnography with some literary foundations, but I'm going to present it in what I'll call the vernacular. Right. One of the issues with academic writing and the ways the academic pieces are presented is they don't hit the street at quite the right speed. And I think what we need to talk about today needs to hit the street. So I'll begin it by saying, starting with the construct, that racism is in fact not dead. Now when I'm going to ask a concession from all of you that are academics who have studied racism or race, and allow us to conflate the words racism and prejudice. They mean two very different things, but they don't normally mean two different things if you're speaking to a lay white audience. So your average white member in South Jordan, Utah, who only thinks about race when one of us brings it up, is not going to listen if you try to explain the difference between racism and prejudice and tell them that black people cannot be racist. They will probably tell you lots of stories of how they're more racist because they said something to them once. Right? So this is not a productive discussion. I'm going to ask that you concede that at this point, and let's conflate the two. Right? So if we say that somebody is racist and you say that, let's just let it go. Let's start and meet people that need to hear the message where they're at. In addition to that, I'd like to forward the notion that everyone possesses prejudice or racism. And it exists on a spectrum, which means that no one is or is not a racist. It means that everybody, in this vernacular, is in fact a racist. It's just a matter of how racist are you at any given point in time. Much as greed or other personal challenges exist within a person, you can be more or less greedy at any given time, and it's not the only thing operating on your spectrum. A person can be incredibly greedy, but also incredibly kind to their children. Right? They can be incredibly thoughtful, all these good things, and possess bad things. It is part of human nature. Prejudice, or a selectivity for our own, a preference for our own, is one of those points on that spectrum. It can be moved and it must be consciously addressed for all of us. So with this idea that all of us possess prejudice, then the next step is to say, if we all possess it, who does it hurt the most? Right? Who loses most often when it comes to racism? So when we're talking about a preference for our own, within Mormonism, the majority of our own are Western, suburban, middle-class white people. That's who the majority of the population is. Right? When we talk about what Mormons look like, when there was a recent study published, I'm not sure where it was published, but I read about it in the Deseret News, talking about someone studied Mormons being able to tell other Mormons by their look. And they drilled it down to the quality of their skin. I wanted desperately to ask, what color was that skin? Did they, in their study, differentiate with the Mormons of color in that study? And if so, were they still able to tell? I'm just going to ask the question and not make any suppositions on what the results of that would be. I really don't know. I'm going to give them the benefit of the doubt. But let's start there to say, who is hurt the most? And predominantly, the vast majority of active members of the American church body are white people. These are the people who need to be most thinking about this, or probably have the most moving or acquiescing to do if we are going to ever make any actual changes. So the first thing we'll start with, I think it was four main points. The first is a friend, starting with Gordon B. Hinckley's statement that a friend is things that every member needs. Every member needs a friend in the church to whom they can constantly turn, who will walk beside you, who will answer your questions, who will understand your problems. Friend is so important. And how do you show that friendship? How do you become a friend? Every black member that I know can point to an instance where somebody was not that friend that they needed, whether intentionally or not. And I would argue that a large portion of that comes from an empathy gap. So a 2012 Pew study surveying Mormons asked active members of the church if they felt that as members of the church they experienced a lot of discrimination. 46% said yes. Those same people were asked if they thought African Americans experienced a lot of discrimination. These same people said that only 31%, they thought only 31% of Americans experienced a lot of discrimination. In essence, these people said that they felt that white Mormons have it worse than black people. So, this next slide is just an illustration of the lived realities of these two demographics. One will ignore the conflation of separating LDS discrimination and black discrimination as if you can't be both. Right? They are not necessarily separated. But so the two columns I have here are from Pew Surveys, NCES, and the US Census. So 54% of people from this study, 50% of LDS people, felt that TV portrayed them poorly. 58% of African Americans feel that TV portrays them poorly. So we're talking about both groups feel that in contemporary America, the public media paints a poor picture of them. So now we're going to move into lived realities, what life is like for real people today. 32% of LDS, active LDS people, have some college. 18% have a bachelor's. 20% of African Americans have some college, 11% a bachelor's. Someone's doing better. 30% or 38% of LDS people are middle class, when the national average is 30. African Americans, 15%. 28% of African Americans live below the poverty line. 678 out of 1,000 white males are in prison. 4,347 out of 1,000 black males are in prison. So this is what it's like for people today. It's not the same experience. And the last column down below, you see the line here. I'm going to talk about where we normally talk about the differences here. In 1838, Extermination Act was signed in one state. In that same year, slavery was legal in 13 states. By 1850, they founded the University of Utah. That's quite a bit of progress. That same year, in 1850, slavery was legal in 15 states. I'm not going the same direction. All of this to say, when we're going to be a good friend, how informed are the present people to be able to actually be an effective friend that those members need? Today, more Americans live in racial isolation than they did in 1965. So this lack of real-life, in-depth, meaningful interaction across racial lines leaves most members of the church ill-prepared to be the friend or relief society president, bishop, or stake president that black members need. Now, I'm talking a lot about white people here. I hope you afford me that privilege. I like white people. Some of my best friends are white people. It's true. But I argue, so this is what I have here. This is American reality. In America, we are still a divided society, and I hold firm to the argument that the Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints has more potential to overcome that American reality than any other American institution. We have the gospel of Jesus Christ as we believe it, a unifying force across all those lines. We have a structure, right, that requires lay participation that if we choose to enact it, if we choose to do the work, we could make amazing strides that nobody else has the potential to do. So the second is missionary misadventures. So the first question I would ask, and not just missionaries as 19-year-olds going out and saying silly things, but what are they saying and why are they saying those and what are we doing about it? And I'd ask the question, are those tasked with training the missionaries any better prepared to deal with and talk about race and racism than those they are charged in training? Most mission presidents, especially in the United States, come from that same racial and socioeconomic status as their missionaries do, which is mostly Western educated white middle class males who are not historically adept or trained, as a general rule, in dealing with these issues. So what are we doing about it? There's a lot of things to talk about. So first, what is our message as it relates to race? We were very clear before 1978 what that message was. We articulated a lot of things in a lot of detail before that. What have we done since then to hedge against that? What have we done about that that can overcome things? For an example, I served as a missionary in Atlanta during the 1996 Olympics. Right? During that time, we set up a big stand that we called Big True, which was this gigantic blue trifold stand with all these Arnold Freiberg illustrations from the Book of Mormon. Right? And it said, the Book of Mormon, it's blue, it's true. And we set up shop in the middle of downtown Atlanta and stood there singing songs and inviting attention, and we got a lot of it. So when it was my turn with four other elders to man this, a gentleman wearing a large tunic, a kufi, and Timberlands came up and closely inspected every one of those illustrations, turned and looked me in the eye and said, where are all the black people? I was unprepared for this question. I looked around to the other missionaries and they all had disappeared. They left it to me, and in a moment of flailing and prayer, I quickly said, they weren't there. It was in America, and they didn't show up until the white people stole them from Africa. What we have is a book with brown people and white people, and they didn't get along. Sometimes one were the good guys, and they switched, the other ones were the bad guys. In the end, they couldn't get along, and the brown people killed all the white people. And the guy looked at that, looked at me, and said, that's a fantastic answer. How much? Right? We gave him a book, went on his way, and all the other missionaries reappeared and told me that was the worst thing they had ever heard in their entire life. I've never heard anybody else teach anything close to it before. I may have taught some variations of it myself since then. But these are missionary misadventures. Why was I unprepared in downtown Atlanta to answer any of these questions? So what tools are available to trainers and teachers? Since that time, we have the essays on race published on LDS.org. But are they in our curriculum? How are they disseminated? Have they hit the street level? And Brian Dawson from Hawaii is here, a Sunday school teacher who taught in his Sunday school class the gospel topics published and approved by the First Presidency of the Church and got directly released from his calling for that. One of the reasons why is because his bishop didn't know it existed and disagreed with everything he said, which was published. And the stake president didn't understand it either. Why do these people not understand this? Right? This is new, I understand, but we can do so much better. We have the tools if we choose to engage them. And how do we get this message out? There's a lot of things that we could do. We have conference addresses, we have the Ensign, we have the MTC, we have BYU, we have manuals. And the biggest thing that I think we need to do is that should be big red words at the bottom. So we need to get ready to be uncomfortable and handle impending disaster. When I say impending disaster, I mean because these conversations, well, I'll put it this way. I have never heard a talk about racism across the pulpit in a sacrament meeting. Never in my life. I've been a member in January. I've been alive for 40 years and a member all that time. Only missed a handful of Sundays because my dad never let me. And it's not because it's an uncomfortable conversation, because I've heard a lot about pornography. I've heard a lot about homosexuality. I've heard a lot of these things where we are okay with dealing with uncomfortable subjects, but not this one. And the other side of this conversation, anytime I tell myself that, is, okay, so who in my ward am I comfortable with if I walked in and sat down and saw, today we're talking about race, who am I going to look up on the stand and be comfortable with when they're walking up to the podium? And it's probably nobody. Right? So, and this is not a Mormon problem. This is an American problem. We are, those of us who are Americans or those of us who have immigrated and are now dealing with this historical American issue have never fully sussed it out. So we as Mormons shouldn't think that we should be so much better than everybody else. We are not better than everybody else. That's a fallacy we need to get over. We should be, we are not. All right, there are existing cultural differences between Mormon cultural institutions and practices, and African-American community. I divided them up into four categories: the Black church, politics, cultural legacy, and spirituality. So the first, you do have to understand there is a reason for the difference in worship styles with African-Americans. We're talking about loud and boisterous. In the early times, this church was the only avenue Black people were allowed to express themselves in. Right? And when you are, and not even in slavery, right? If we're talking back through Jim Crow times, when you are living in a society where no matter how hard you work, you are guaranteed to not be successful, your only hope is for a better afterlife, and the least you can do is on Sunday have a chance to let off some steam, be with some people, to give you some emotional uplift, right? As opposed to our concept of quiet reverence. Right? These are conflicting worship styles. And there are reasons for those. I'm not saying either is superior. I'm saying these are existing differences that we need to be willing to engage. The Black church has historically been the center of political and social organization. Right? And I'll put the historical avenue of professional opportunity together. You have to understand that historically, even in the first times when African Americans were allowed a college education, the rub was, after you graduate, there are no jobs for you to use your college education in. The only historical exception to that is in the Black ministry. So when you look at historical Black leaders coming out of the church, many of that is because that is the only avenue of income for educated Black men, predominantly. We teach in our church that the church itself should be apolitical. We might not enact that all the time, but it is not the place where we do not come to sacrament meetings, and it would be very inappropriate for us to come to a sacrament meeting and try and register voters for a specific party, right? That would be inappropriate, or to campaign for a specific candidate on Sunday in sacrament meeting, right? That was a standard practice in the Black church. It was the only avenue of organization available, and a very effective one. So this is the historical relevance and cultural relevance of these institutions, which are the direct polar opposite of how we express Mormonism currently. So just on the political spectrum, right? African Americans, as a general rule, are socially conservative and solidly Democrat. Latter-day Saints are socially conservative and predominantly Republican. Right? The church requires the whole person. Right? It does require the political you. That is okay. Political dialogue and discourse should be fine. But understanding these two dichotomies, when somebody is trying to be fellowshipped into a new church, an African American in anywhere walking into this white church, meet some new, nice, friendly people, and then friend them on Facebook, and then read that Black people only vote for handouts. So if I back up to this, talking about the historical Black church, and the political avenues, and then they are told by the people that are supposed to be fellowshipping them that Black people vote for handouts, what are we expected to do with their testimony? How are they expected to still nurture that? And I'll get to that in a minute. And also the cultural legacy. I'll start with the Mormons, since that's where I know. I was raised on this lore of being persecuted in Missouri, moving out west to get away from it all, and where we picked ourselves up by our bootstraps, and we succeeded, and we've re-entered the world, and we are awesome in everything. To the point where I, at one time, could tell you every but one with any Utah or Mormon connections playing in the NFL. That's why I decided what team to root for, who had the most Mormons. These were my people, and we did it by ourselves in Utah. And we came here to escape federal forces, and that's how it should be done. The African-American community has a different story. Right? This overcoming of oppression through collective activism. They had to come together as a group and mobilize, and then even once they legally won their rights, they still weren't given those rights until federal troops enforced them receiving those rights. Completely different idea of federal intervention. Right? Complete different idea of the idea and the possibilities and the benefits of big government that's not in the cultural norm of traditional Mormons. Now, in spirituality, I would say that one of the biggest reasons why we do have remaining black members is the tendency for black Mormons to have an appreciation for spirituality and religion. People who have testimonies that allow them to overcome things that people say and things that people do. My wife told me I could share this story. I don't tell people. I don't think about it very often because I don't like to think about it. When she spent 2 years in Utah, she considers that her mission, right? We spent 2 years going other places. She spent 2 years here at the University of Utah, loved the institution, had such a great academic experience. When she got engaged, her roommate who worked in the church office building kindly delivered to her, out of her concern for my wife, a hand-typed copy of a talk given by an apostle talking about how the worst thing you can do is marry interracially because black people were not valiant and unworthy in the pre-existence, and the only reason why civil rights is being pushed for is because black people want to intermarry with white people. Big stamps on it that say, do not remove from church office building. She kindly delivered that to my wife. What good is supposed to come of that? And the only reason why my wife really paid no mind to that, even when I talked to her today, she's like, why, I don't care, is because she had a patriarchal blessing that stated explicitly, you were valiant in the pre-existence. She's like, whatever, I got a trump card. God bless that patriarch. Were it not for that man, who knows? My wife doesn't listen to most of those people anyway, so it probably didn't matter. So the last one, this one is not always directly tied to race. If any of you were here for the morning session with Segru, who talks about the history of how American inner cities became what they are today, it was intentional and deliberate in many ways how, especially East Coast, Iron Belt cities became what they are. Dense urban populations, high concentration of poverty. So I call this the stifling force of modern generational poverty, and I did some funky math. So if any of you are math people here, don't mess with me on this. I'm making a point. But I devised this in Philadelphia with actual ward numbers and with actual demographic numbers. We were in a ward that was roughly maybe 5 square miles that I pulled the Bureau of Business Statistics. Found we had over 100,000 people per square mile. Right, that's how many we had. We had roughly 10 active solid members. Right, they were like willing to do call, or families, I'll say. So 10, but really 10 people that were really doing the work. Because really when the church talks about its resources, the resource that it implements the most is a middle class, right, solid income family, right? Active, with some experience behind them, that's the resource. It's not dollars, right? We find dollars in other places. So we had 10 of those, so that's B, right? So up there where you have A, so new members trying to do their hardest, but they knew to food order. At any given time, we probably had 50 of those. Right. Is that an accurate number?
Yeah.
All right. Add that to C, which is members with little resources, but unstable living situations. One thing we found that was rather interesting is people who have lived with nothing, right, do pretty good at living with nothing. They don't need food orders, right? But they move every 2 weeks, right? They move every 2 weeks because they're paying $10 for rent because the landlord doesn't want to fix the toilet, right? So they say, I'll charge you no rent if you don't report the toilet. Then somebody else comes in and says, hey, that's broken, that's got to be fixed, or I'm taking away your kids, and so they move, right? So these sort of things happen. It's a very transient, they're not going to be able to give a ride to the storehouse, don't have a car. D, a new member who's stable, but new and facing temptation. They haven't quite got the hang of this Mormonism thing for anybody. It's not, you don't get the hang of it in 2 seconds, right? It takes some adjustment. And then Z is everybody else. If you've lived in East Coast cities, everybody else is in fact on top of you all of the time. I never had to turn on the Eagles games on Sundays because I knew the score because it came through the walls on both sides. in what we consider the house. So if you reduce this fraction, if that is possible, and it illustrates what those active members are expected to bear, if that's the church's resource, if this is how we are delivering help to those in need, is that proportionate to that need? And the reality is that the majority of these people in need, and the majority of the reality in places like Philadelphia and other East Coast places, is that all those people on top are Black and Latino and immigrants. You have some of those on the bottom, they're there. Then you have the spattering of people moving through Wall Street or graduate students that are doing a tour, right? So maybe that's one of the ways. I think we do some amazing work with those people doing a tour. I have seen miracles. No explanation for anything other than miracles of graduate students and people doing a tour, as I'm calling it, who are so dedicated and do wonderful, meaningful work. And it's probably good that they're doing a tour because you can't sustain that. You can't do that for a lifetime or for a career. Then they go to Utah and be a dentist, right? That this is really what happens. But it does pose the question, is our response proportionate to the problem? And I would argue in many instances, in many places like that, it isn't. Now, my proposals for these things do not require any doctrinal changes. They do not require any real acquiescence from church leadership or anything of that nature. It does not need to shake anyone's testimony. These are things that I think we can, in fact, do for the most part. So the first thing is reframing the race discussion from the top. Meaning, any discourse, and I'll say even a talk on race at the ward level, will not be well received unless it is parroting something directly said by church leaders. Right? An illustration of this is when a Sunday school teacher teaches published words on a website from church leaders, he gets released because they didn't hear it. Because they didn't see it, they didn't know it, they have not been modeled that appropriate way to teach this message. The easy way is, let's model a way to teach that message. We can do that in general conference. We can do that in articles in the Ensign, the Liahona. I think those are, in many ways, I don't think it should be one or the other, many ways superior. I, as somebody who likes to think about these things, would feel much safer with somebody walking up to the podium with an Ensign article on these subjects than riffing from what they remember from a talk or something. There's a lot more back-checking that goes into these things. Training and education on race at BYU and the MTC, right? What is being taught? We just had a panel talk about these sort of things. And I would argue it's not just what is taught to Black people that matters. It is what is taught to white people. We'll re-articulate that BYU is probably the greatest exporter of Mormon practice in the country because those people leave and go work for their lifetimes in other places that are not Provo, where Black people live and where other members of the church live, and they enact what they learned at BYU in their wards and in their units. That's why I shaved today, so that you guys would listen to me a little bit better, because I know that there's BYU people. That is a joke, but it's a very serious idea, that things are modeled. Brown faces in official public spaces. So there is a lot of higher ed data that shows that one of the reasons why African Americans on many college campuses felt unwelcome and they couldn't put a finger on why, they realized it'd be at a place like at Ole Miss, where they show up and there's the main congregation space for all the students was this quad that was surrounded by all the historical fathers of the university. No Black people ever went there. I said, like, Black folks, why don't you go hang out with all of your friends? They said, well, have you gone there? And they went and looked, and all those university fathers are Confederate generals. Right? You physically do not feel comfortable in that place. We luckily do not have these antagonistic spaces, but specifically with African Americans, what message do we portray of welcome? If you walk into a building and all of the faces are white, you see a painting on the wall of a host of angels, and all of the angels are white. If you see the Savior ministering to a crowd of children, and all of them are white or pretty close, right? What message is being given that you are in fact welcome? right? And the same issue does not always operate with other ethnicities that might be of color. Say if you are Spanish, being delivered a Book of Mormon in your mother tongue is a meaningful offering, right? This is for me. There is no like offering to African Americans to give them that space. So I'd say increased inner city full-time support. Senior missionaries do wonderful work. They generally serve shorter terms and sometimes take a lot of old ideas and habits to unlearn, which really shortens their term of effectiveness. But once they're effective, they're irreplaceable. We need more of those. We need more people willing to serve and more people willing to serve where they are called to serve. And I think that we could do some work, including, I know Jermaine and I have talked about, and I am a big proponent of Ruby Payne's work. She has a book, Bridges Out of Poverty, that is a great text in how to help people from a middle class experience contextualize people living in a culture of poverty, that they are not crazy and irresponsible, they're making very rational decisions from their perspectives. Very helpful for Mormons proselyting and serving in those populations to understand. This last one is the one that's my flyer. So give me my flyer. In community boarding schools. If you've lived in a place like Philadelphia, you know that public education, that's like the test case of failed public education. There are a host of all sorts of ideas to overcome, though. There's this rich melting pot in places of New Orleans and Philadelphia of ideas to overcome that. None of them overcome the educational plus the gospel obstacles that these youth face. Having an in-community boarding school, like Girard College in Philadelphia, which has 100% placement of their students, all of which coming from single-parent poverty homes in colleges, most of them elite colleges, is drastic. I tell you, the consequences in these places are currently equally drastic and will continue to be so until we take equally drastic measures. Nothing that we have done in the past 40 years of my lifetime has really made a huge dent. Right? The needle has moved in times, but that poverty persists. In the Philadelphia ward that I served in, never in its history, or the history of the church there, has sent out a missionary that grew up there. Never once. Active church base. We almost got one, but they split the ward, and so he didn't count.
We sent him out.
But Grant, that's now two wards, one missionary. Why is that? Is that because there are no faithful saints? Is that because they are just less faithful than people in other parts of the country? I would argue no, because I've met those people and I grew up in places where we are thought to be more faithful and we're not. It's the obstacles are in fact greater. And we cannot expect people to overcome greater obstacles unless they're given greater tools to do so. That is what I have. So with that, the panelists have each had time to digest and come up with all sorts of responses, which I welcome. So it might just be easiest to move down the line. Sure. And so Jermaine, microphone's yours.
Sure. Wow, that was deep, Dalyn. Well, first of all, thank you, Dalyn and Paul and all those who have participated in organizing this conference, and thank you for the invitation to be here and share some thoughts and hopefully add some value to what has already been shared throughout this day and into the evening yesterday. You know, as you were commenting, and I had written down some notes earlier, I was just reflecting on my first interaction of a Mormon ward. He mentioned I was baptized in Alabama, and shortly thereafter moved to Atlanta, Georgia, and attended the singles ward. And I remember, you know, I'm from Alabama, had an interesting pre-church life. You know, I have arms filled with tattoos going into my first Sunday of going to the singles ward, a gold tooth as I march into this Mormon congregation, not knowing exactly what to expect. And didn't see anyone who looked like me. And that was, as you might imagine, a very interesting experience for someone who grew up in working class, African American, and never really interacted with many people of many Caucasians, many white people. But I had an interesting experience that was important for me, and I don't know where my church experience would have turned had I not had this very important experience. I was in an activity at the singles ward, and we were playing volleyball or something, and I was just standing there really feeling uncomfortable as my wife and I were the only two black people there. And I just felt uncomfortable. No one had necessarily done anything, said anything. It was a sort of natural awkwardness and uncomfortability of the differences of history and so forth. But suddenly the Spirit said to me, "Jermaine, these are your brothers and sisters." And it was so powerful. It touched me so deeply. I think I actually may have shed a tear when I experienced that. But that really, I guess I would say, changed the course of my experience in the church. It really gave me understanding and insight into what I had actually joined and what I was going to be participating in as a member of the church. So I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful for that insight. As a member, new member of the singles ward. Now, after going on a mission, as I daily mentioned, my wife directly, and she said it in a much more direct way than he mentioned. We were, in fact, at the singles ward, and she just said to me, "Hey, you know what? I like you. You're cool. But you need to go on a mission, come back so we can get married." I'm like, okay. Hadn't really considered that. Didn't even know that I could serve as a missionary for the church, but I prayed about it and decided that that's what the Lord wanted me to do. After we got married, I went to, she wanted actually to attend her ward, the ward she had grown up in, which was predominantly white. And we thought about it, prayed about it, and decided that we were going to go to Southwest Atlanta and check out the Atlanta ward, which, if some of you, Paulette is a member of the Atlanta ward of my stake, it is maybe 60-40, 60% African American, 40% Caucasian, a few Latinos, maybe a Vietnamese. It's a very interesting, eclectic collection of people there in the Atlanta ward. I ended up serving as the bishop there for 6 years in the Atlanta ward. And what I would share with you about that particular ward experience, and I use this language as I wrote down in my notes, the value of meaningful proximity. I think it was mentioned in an earlier panel. I don't know what he used similar language, but the power of having students from Georgia Tech who came out from BYU, they attend Georgia Tech, they attend Georgia State University, and the local people to meaningfully interact with one another, to serve as home and visiting teachers to one another, to serve in callings with one another, was just a powerful experience, a powerful thing for me to be able to witness. And then hopefully we can talk a little bit more. I think President Johnson perhaps can comment a bit more on that as well. Let me comment finally on this idea of resources. Elder Sitati mentioned something very interesting about the way the international church gets resources to its members. Now, currently in the United States, in Atlanta, Georgia, we have an employment resource center that is very far away from the urban center where the resources are most needed. And you obviously have transportation issues, and people can't get to the bishop may suggest, hey, you need to go and get your resume completed. You need to go get some interview practice or whatever the case may be, and it's difficult for members to get out to those resources. But what they do in the international church, they don't have any employment resource centers. They hire employment managers, but they work locally with wards and stakes to get those resources to the members. We recently implemented exactly what Elder Sitate mentioned in his talk. We implemented that in the Atlanta ward, that 12-week program. We had a very small number of people participating in it, maybe 7 people. None of them had jobs when they entered the program. When they finished, 5 of them had 1 job, 2 of them had 2 jobs. I mean, it's really a powerful resource. And I hope that as we learn more about this, and I think the plan is for this to expand across wards and stakes here in the United States. But I would just stop there and just leave it for other panelists to comment.
So I'm speaking on my experience in Washington, D.C., and if any of you know about Washington, D.C., although it is one of the wealthiest cities in the nation, it has some of the highest rates of poverty and some of the highest rates of HIV. And so I want to start off with an old adage, and I'm sure a lot of you know about it. It's that if you give a person a fish, okay, I'm just gonna make sure you guys. But I think in terms of Black saints at the ward level, at the stake level, there's a variant on the second part of that, and it's if you give a person, or if you teach a person to fish, it doesn't matter if the person doesn't own a part of the pond. And I think that speaks to the stake that Black saints have within the church and within our individual wards. And so that brings me to ask, how do we help Black members have a greater stake in their church communities? And even further, what are the best ways to care for Black saints instead of just providing a service? And so in the church it's really big on volunteer service, right? And it does a very great good for many members. But there's also this idea of a service providing a product. And so when you're expecting a product, whether it's just membership numbers or it's just tithing, you start seeing members as clients, and that takes away that element of love and care that is necessary for Black saints to grow. And so in talking about that love and care that is necessary for saints to grow, I wanted to point to an asset-based community model. And so what that is exactly what it sounds like. It's you take what the church has, which is like the employment centers, you have the storehouses, and you add that on to what members already have, their skill set and their knowledge base. And you build on a holistic model. In the African-American tradition, there's this idea of the connection between the body and the soul. And so I think in an asset-based model, you're able to speak to, if you're nourishing the body, you're able to nourish the soul and vice versa. And I talk about an asset-based model in comparison to only looking at what people don't have. I think sometimes we kind of slip into this, well, they're living in poverty, they don't have education. This is not to say to ignore the disparities in healthcare and education and income, but when we only look through that lens, we start, and some people, and they'll use the word deficiency, I think it's a very negative term, but when you only look at those quote-unquote deficiencies in a community, you start to see people within that community as deficient. And for example, just a personal example, I was in a primary, I was working in primary, and they were giving kids out snacks. I didn't get any, I was a little upset about that. But there was one young lady, African-American, she rose her hand and she said she didn't get a snack. And so one of the primary leaders took her to the back, and I was sitting there, I was watching what was happening, and she told her to empty her pockets in the back of this class. And we talk about, you know, what would Jesus do? Well, what would Jesus do? But in talking about what did Jesus do, and that's not something that Jesus, I feel, would do in that situation. And so there's a lot, in my particular ward, there are a lot of African-American and Latino children. And so when seeing that, it's just, I know what that means, and being so young and being exposed to that, what that does to a person's psyche. And so I think as saints, our goal should be to help people achieve their greatest good. And all the isms, the racism, sexism, classism, all the phobias, xenophobia, transphobia, homophobia, keep people from doing so. But I think sometimes in trying to achieve the greatest good, we slip into this theological and cultural mold within the LDS faith that happens to be American, and oftentimes it's a white American mold. And this mold, it benefits some saints. And I'm not going to take anything away from that, but I don't believe that this mold really speaks to those who experience racism and white supremacy. And it doesn't speak to the holistic approach to wellness that black bodies need. It doesn't speak to justice. Not this idea of eye for an eye, but the idea that God is with the oppressed. And so I think when we're approaching this idea of love and care, it's letting members speak, and those who are affected by these things. And so when I was thinking about the audience, people who are here and speaking to this, and so you don't have to, no one has to raise their hand, please don't raise your hand. Just think about it in the back of your mind, how many people here are experiencing food insecurity or have at some point in their lives? How many people are working multiple jobs just to put food on the table? How many people here are not making a living wage? And if people were to really raise their hand and nobody rose their hand, the question should be why? Why are those people not here? And in that, I think sometimes it slips back into that theological and cultural mold that we set up, this, you know, we're okay, so everyone else will be okay, right? And then I think it speaks back to, go a little biblical on you guys. Before Saul was made king, the Israelites lived in this covenant communion with Yahweh. So you had this connect, this relationship with Yahweh to the Israelites and the Israelites to God. There was no hierarchy. But after Saul was made king, it created this hierarchy. So you had the king, you had people who protected the king, like, so for example, like Nehemiah, and then you had people who protected them, and then at the very bottom, you had people who were producing for those at the top. And I think so when we're creating these programs, when we're creating these, we create this mold, we're looking at people at the bottom through this, the king's lens. And when you do that, we further distance ourselves from that covenant community that the Bible speaks of returning to. And so I think it's so important to listen to let the least of these speak, because when we hear them speak, we hear the word of God. And I think we forget that sometimes. And so it returns to the question, how do we help black saints have a greater stake in our community? And I guess my answer is maybe you get rid of the idea of owning that pond and that God is only for you, and rather that God is for all of us. And through that, we can achieve the greatest good for others. Thank you.
It is it's truly an honor to be here. It has been a wonderful conference for me to attend. I appreciate the invitation to be here, and Brother Montgomery sent me his essay. And I was reading his essay, and I had to think a little bit, just a little background. I'm in academia. I'm a professor at a university. I critique research for journals and editors, and I write research myself. And so when someone sends me an essay, my different eyes come on. So I have two thoughts of him later that I'll share more from that perspective. But I enjoyed reading his thought piece and then once again listening to his presentation to get his views. And I enjoy being here this morning and listening to the dialogue and the experiences. And I wrote just a few thoughts as I kind of try to identify myself and my peace and my place in our discussions, and especially the one that deals with how can we improve race relationships on a ward and state level and what we are doing in Bessemer. So I'm gonna give you some thought pieces from what we're doing in Alabama with our state presidency. But just a thought that came to my mind is, as we kind of look at the purpose of this conference and the things that we do, and something to this effect, I mean, it's, we are reviewing and understanding our past so that we can understand the present, so we can change our thoughts and our hearts to better prepare for the future. And so I think everything has its context of what we're trying to do. And as I listen also, another thought came to my mind that each of us, regardless of our racial background or perspective, has what we call defining moments. Defining moments that defined us. President Sullivan shared one earlier, and you shared earlier in the panel discussion. We have those defining moments. So let me just give you just a couple of my defining moments that I think have kind of helped me better understand who I am, what my purpose is, and probably even more important than that, who I can become. So as kind of was mentioned, I joined the church when I was 19, converting from the Nation of Islam. I was part of the Ansar faith, which is an offset from Elijah Muhammad and the teachings of Malcolm X in New York City. And so my journey first began in investigating the church as being converted to Christianity, which is different, which I love that because through that process, I got to know my Savior. I got to know Jesus Christ, and then I joined the church and was baptized. A year later, following my baptism, I had the opportunity to serve a mission to the great state of Alabama, to where I'm living now, right? Weird experience. Love being in Alabama. I love what I'm seeing. I love serving there as a missionary. And my first defining moment, if you will, came 4 months into my mission. As we was teaching some of the Yahweh faith, me and my companion was in their home and teaching the gospel of Christ. And this African-American brother looked at me with curiosity in his eyes and simply said, "I am surprised to see you here." And I thought that was an interesting question or a comment. And I said, "Well, why are you surprised to see me here?" And he talked about the restriction on the priesthood. And of course, my introduction to the church came from a very good friend of mine, Danny Frazier, who's African-American. And so as he's proceeded to share those experiences with me, I, of course, denied him, right? Challenging him, you know? And my companion just was sitting there in total shock. And I'm trying to say, "No, that's not true. I don't know where you get your information from," and yada, yada, yada. So I walked out of the meeting. I tell my companion, I said, "Can you believe that?" And he looked at me. He says, "You really don't know, do you?" And I said, "What is it that I don't know?" And I love Kevin Vick, who was the best man at my wedding, proceeded to tell me about the restriction and the ban on blacks in the priesthood that was listed in 1978. So here, 16 months into the church, I've never heard that. And so find that out in Inslee, Alabama, which is an inner city, which I'll talk about that experience here in a minute. That was quite, it was a defining moment for me. And being from the Nation of Islam, and if you understand that teaching, then to have this, it's kind of put a different perspective on my world. And so I had to do some things. Needless to say that there was no missionary work that got done for the next 2 weeks. Sure, we got up every morning, and sure, we went out, but the Spirit had left me. I felt betrayed. I felt lied to. It was a very difficult and a challenging, like I said, a defining moment for me. So I had a choice to make. Leave the mission, return home, or try to figure out, well, who am I? And then in the midst of these 2 weeks, my companion, like I said, Kevin Vick, every night, said these words to me, "Elder Johnson, I love you." And that's all he could say, because we wasn't having any dialogue. But he mentioned those words every night. And then I guess what broke the ice for me was answering the phone from a dear sister missionary who was also serving, and she said those same words, "Elder Johnson, I love you." And I had to think about that for a minute. And then that caused me to open up the scripture just a little bit. And I came across a scripture found in a Doctrine and Covenants, section 6, verse 22 and 23, where the Lord is speaking to Oliver Cowdery and says these words, "Did I not speak peace to your mind concerning the matter? What greater witness can you have than from God?" And I had to reflect on my prayer when I asked the Lord, "Is the Church of Jesus Christ thy kingdom on this earth? And is Joseph Smith a prophet?" I didn't see any visions, but it was a peace and a witness to me as I knelt upon my knees in that prayer, and I remembered. And I felt once again the love of the Lord in that moment, and I knew that I was a child of God, that I had not been deceived, but yet there was things I needed to know. And so I took that experience, and I had to think, well, I'm staying on a mission because there's things I need to do. And I'm going to put this on a shelf just a little bit and do some research when I get home. And of course, I have and I've done. I'll give you my own perspective of that in a minute. And so that was the first defining moment for me. And then returning, finished graduating from college, married, 4 children, loved them all. My oldest daughter served a mission in Mexico City. My second daughter's on a mission to Cape Verde. My 2 sons are 16 and 13. And my wife is wonderful. So the next defining moment or experience happened with my daughter, who was getting baptized at the age of 8. Her name is Whitney, and we live in Arizona. I'm doing my doctoral work at Arizona State. And we was looking forward to her baptism day with all excitement. And we went to the baptism, we invited friends and family, and we had a great bishop. I love him today, but he didn't understand a lot. But I love him, because I learned a lot from him as I had the chance to serve with him. But a defining moment came the second time in his race relation and understanding blacks in the church. When my daughter was baptized, he loved my daughter, but he welcomed her in the church. And she was afraid to be baptized. I mean, she was 8 and didn't know a lot. We were trying to teach the gospel in the home. She was just 8 years old. But she came up and he introduced her, brought her to there and welcomed her in the church and said, "We love to welcome Whitney Houston," right? Whitney Houston. Whitney, like, "I'm not Whitney Houston." And I love her music. I'm not, you know, even on there. And I'm like, and we thought, okay, made a mistake. But Whitney, what effect it had on her and her experience, because it didn't happen there on that Saturday. It happened on Sunday when he invited her up again and turned down the whole congregation, and he did it the second time. And then I had to say to myself, okay, what is going on here? And what do I do? Was we offended? Of course we was, because we were shy. We wanted everything to be perfect for our little daughter. And she never wanted to talk to the bishop again. Any bishop, for that matter. But she got over it, served the mission, did wonderful. But we laugh at that moment now. But we had another chance to choose how to react to that moment and what to teach in our home in response to that. Another lesson, life lesson, a greater lesson for Whitney. So let me share with you a little bit now. So I've been in, there's a lot of discussion about BYU. I taught at BYU for 8 years. I didn't get tenure. I taught at BYU Hawaii for 4 years. Love BYU Hawaii, love the mission of the institution. Now I'm at the best institution ever, the University of Alabama. Got there in 2011, love it. Been called into the stake presidency in 2013, so almost serving 3 years. And let me just show you one other defining moment now in my, and it's not my stake, I wanna be very careful there. I have the opportunity to serve in this part of the Lord's vineyard, and I'm grateful for it. So the call was extended to me, and being new in the stake, only there for a year, I was there for 6 months by myself as my daughter was graduating here in Utah. We didn't want to move her, so I went there 6 months and lived there for 6 months. No one knew my family, my wife, and I was given all kinds of callings the first 6 months. The second 6 months, I was given all kinds of callings. So when I got my call to actually serve as a stake president, I didn't know anyone in the stake, and no one knew me. And so the first thing I told the members of the stake is that I know you don't know me, and I don't know you, but the Lord knows you, and I know the Lord. And so the stake, 15,000 square miles, 12 units, two inner city type congregations, a Latino Spanish speaking congregation. Nine of the 12 unit leaders, and this goes against Brother Montgomery in his talk there, are not BYU affiliates. Two of the units in our state are led by African Americans. The inner city branch is prospering and growing and struggling. Prospering and growing and struggling. So we love that branch. That branch over the last 2.5 years have sent out 5 African American missionaries. 3 have now returned home. We have worked with them and their families. They don't have the financial support, single parent homes, all the things you can put on them to attribute why they can't succeed. 3 of those young men, one is attending BYU Idaho, one is attending BYU, and one is attending Southern University of Virginia, because he didn't want to come out west. But each of those experiences, and we have to be very careful because we want them to be self-reliant, and I can give you my spiel about the difference between self-sufficient and self-reliance. I think we have to be very careful how we choose those words because we all need to rely on the Savior so we're never completely self-sufficient. Anyhow, so 3, 2 are still coming. One comes home in November. The other one comes home in December. Two of them have served in Ghana, and those 2 missions in Ghana and experience of that experience. The other one served in Denver, Colorado, and the other one served in Idaho. But having very tremendous and wonderful experiences. But we teach them the importance of education and self-reliance, and we're trying to make a difference in their lives. So why did we send them abroad, and why did they not come back to this inner city branch and make this place greater? Well, I look at my own life. I grew up in New York City, received a college education around the world. I'm better now able to help my family than any time before. The first to go to college, the first to graduate. And so I want them to have that complete experience, get educated, and then come back to make a difference. And I think they will when that opportunity presents itself for them. So those 5 young men, great serving. We have other African American males throughout our state serving as well. One went to London and served brilliant. He's back home, got home in September. Wonderful, and of course my 2 daughters are African American, they serve too, so. And they left from Alabama. So that's just what we're doing there. So how are we doing this? What are we doing? Is there anything systematic that we're doing? I think yes, we have to be systematic in our process. We can't leave it a chance. It won't get done that way. We have to be organized, and we also have to invite and a lot of prayer and talking with our Heavenly Father. So one thing, what we put an African-American branch president in that intercity. Prior to going there, we were sending people from other outside communities coming into that ward. And that was good, that was helpful. They was bringing somebody, they was bringing a different perspective. This African-American male that we call to be branch president has lived a block away from that branch building for over 20 years. He has come from them. And so when they look up and see him presiding and leading in his black church style, which we love to go to Inslee, they see in someone they can become and inspire to be like. And that has made a difference. So that's one thing. And then I meet with that branch president weekly because one thing he tells me, he says, you know, President, I've never seen all this. He's never been in a leadership position before. He's never an elders quorum president or a high priest group leader or anything like that. And here now he's the branch president. But he says, President, all my life, or since I joined the church over 20 years ago, I thought everyone paid tithing. I thought everyone did this. I said, President Scruggs, welcome to our world, buddy. Right? We all come at different levels and from different perspectives, and now you have a chance to minister and to uplift. And so we help him train him so he can train his members and make a difference. So that's one thing. The second thing, we're trying to help our members understand in the Bessemer, Alabama stake that there's a difference from being active in the church and active in the gospel. There's a big, big difference and they're not the same. And so we're trying to help our members, what does it mean to be active in the gospel and use the words of the Savior through the prophet Alma when he says it's by the preaching of the word of God that has a greater effect on the people's lives than anything else. And so we help them understand what it means to become active in the gospel and develop faith in their Heavenly Father in Jesus Christ, and to have that change of heart, then that will lead them to change their condition. And so that's what we hope, that's what we're seeing, that's what we're preaching and testifying of, because we want to increase people's faith in God and in our Savior Jesus Christ, because that's the only way, having that relationship. So when they face certain challenges, I know I did, when we have these challenges and afflictions and challenges, and we all have them, no one's immune, the only way we can overcome and be uplifted is knowing that God lives and Jesus is the Christ. And I tell my members, I don't believe that. I know that, and know that knowing my Savior has helped change my condition and what I've been able to do in this life by knowing him. Have I had challenges and afflictions? Yes. Do I drive a BMW or a Lexus? No, right? I brought a Honda Civic for a reason. 15,000 square miles, I get 35 miles to the gallon, right? So they see a state president pulling up in a Honda Civic that can really only fit one. I'm like, well, who's this guy? Huh? And that's the way it is, right? And so we try to do that. And so one, let people see what they can become, and by inviting people to lead out from the African-American community. Two, teach the difference between what it means to be active in the church and active in the gospel. And third, education. Education, education, right? Education, education, education. What it means to go to college, what it means to learn a trade or ability, right? What does it mean to acquire knowledge to be able to make a difference? And so we instill that, right? For example, these five young men who serve missions, what we've done with each one of them, 6 months before they come home for their missions, I call their mission president, and I says, what have you talked to them about what they're going to do when they come home? What's your last interview like? One mission president says, thank you, Elder Johnson. I was so worried what we're going to do with this elder when he comes home. I said, we need to sit down and start planning. I'm glad the church came with this new program called My Plan, because it's doing that. But I talk to these mission presidents and say, hey, let's talk to them about education opportunities. I don't want to tell them where they're going to go to school. I don't want to do that. I want them to exercise their agency, but I want them to be thinking about that. So when they come home, we have a plan in place. So when these three young men came home, they had already discussed with me through letters with the mission president, we had a plan in place. So when they got home, they wasn't gonna linger around and do nothing. They was gonna get themselves together and get them out and get to school, and that's what we've done. And so far they're doing well. We got one that's still struggling in school, so I got on him the other day. Now he's not answering my text, but we're dealing with that. So those three things, right? Those three things, and I hope we're making a difference. I hope it's sustainable. And so because when my time is just short there, right? I'm not gonna be a state president forever, but if we can train and uplift and put a model in place for people to be successful and understand what it means to have a knowledge and a witness of God and his son, then I hope doing that, we can continue to make a difference. Thank you.
I actually want to start by answering two things that Dalyn mentioned in the opening part of his presentation. The first part of why is it we're able to have African American members stay in the church and the gospel, even though there are all of these obstacles and hurdles that would seemingly make it so easy for us to leave and walk away. And then the other thing I want to briefly answer right now is how do we help Black saints have a greater stake in their wards and the leadership of their wards? And I want to touch upon the first thing by saying, like many others who have spoken today. I was born and raised in the church. My parents joined when I was two in the Denver, Colorado stake. Pretty much my entire youth growing up, we were the only black family in the ward, the only black family in the stake. So, and like many of the other people have spoken, during that time when you get to be 15, 16, 17, and you start dating, issues come up, you know, from time to time. And so I had seen with my older sister as well, there really isn't any dating in the church because that's not just going to happen for us. And so it was actually, and so unlike some of the other panelists, about that time, around the age of 17 or 18, I actually went inactive and stopped coming to church for about 8 years. So when I was 25, at that time, I had moved to Philly, and I had been out there for about 2 years. And at that time, I felt a longing and a desire to go back to church again. So I found the ward nearest me. I walked in, and what to my eyes? Black people. Seriously, I walked out of sacrament meeting. I called my mom back home. I said, "Mom, there are black people. More than one, there are black people here." Just the joy I had, you know, from all those years growing up, being the only black family, it was so eye-opening, and it was such a refreshing feeling to know that I was no longer the only one. And so about 6 months later, and I know, so Miss Kathy Stokes over here, she may not remember this, but about 6 months later, so again, mind you, I had been inactive 8 years. 6 months later, they called me to be Lead Society President. I was single, lived in Philly, worked up in Manhattan. And so my mom had met Sister Kathy years ago, and my mom said, "Here, take this number and call Sister Stokes, ask her for advice." So I called you one Sunday afternoon, and you said, "Well, you were called for a reason. You know what you need to do." And let me tell you, I was so petrified of the calling because, again, I had been inactive. I had really never been in Relief Society before. And in the ward I was attending, it was a family ward. I'm going to go out on a limb from memory, about 90% of the people in the ward were married with kids. Most of them were students who were from the western states out here going to dental and medical school, and here I was, the outlier, not married, no kids, didn't serve on a mission, but hey, I'm called the teacher sisters. And so I told myself, well, if this is what they want, I'll do it. And the only goal I had for myself was when they finally release me, I'll be happy if there are at least two sisters who still come. That's how scared I was of the calling. And it was an amazing time. In the morning session, Jake mentioned how in Philadelphia there was this amazing growth. I so happened to be in one of the wards during that time that was having this amazing growth. During that time, the Montgomerys also moved into the ward, and we were baptizing about 5 to 6 people every week. Wow. And the needs were plentiful. Our ward at the time covered about a third of the city. And if you know anything about Philadelphia, it is one of the top three cities with the highest rates of deep poverty. So pretty much everybody we were baptizing had immense needs. They were either unemployed, severely underemployed, didn't have a high school diploma, didn't have a GED, didn't hold jobs for very long periods of time. And so there were always needs. And so, as Dalyn mentioned earlier, one of the things we did have We had incredible students from the Mountain West. I think that as I look back on it now, had they not been students and not purposefully had a short time span there, we would have burned them out. Because as I look back now, I know it was only by the grace of God, I probably didn't go berserk and crazy with all the needs that we were having to take care of and all the people we were learning to care for and to teach and to help them grow in the gospel, and not just help them grow in the gospel, but to help them become stable individuals who had homes and food on the table every night. And it was kind of some of the things that helped to keep me going during this time was there were two older black sisters in the ward. They were late 60s, early 70s, but just about every Sunday they would walk up to me, give me a hug, and say, "Thank you for being you. We never thought we would see it the day we would have a Black Police Society president here." And they were just the sweetest sisters. And I think we sometimes underestimate the effect it has on seeing people who look like you in positions of power, so to speak, not just on the young, but also on the older people. And and so I served in that calling for 5.5 years, which is where a lot of this grade comes from. but the other thing I wanted to address is why it's important for us to not only as we're reaching out to teach people the gospel and to bring them unto the knowledge of the fullness of the Savior, is that we empower them so that they can go out and lead, and they can bring other families in, and they can bring other souls back to Christ. Because when it's difficult at times when you don't have people who one of the phrases I like to use often is what lens do you see through? When you don't have people who are your leaders, who don't see through your lens or don't understand your lens, meaning they're not. And when I say lens, what lens are you seeing through? I am meaning, you know, experiences in life, your race, your heritage, your age, gender, socioeconomic status. But it's important, especially for our youth, to know that their leaders see through a similar lens, that they understand what those youth are going through, and that the advice and the answers that they give them, that they're coming from a place of love, honesty, and experience, not just, "Well, this sounds good, and it made sense in my life," although your life is a 180 degrees difference, I think you can make it work in your life. That's not what our youth need. And I say this, although I was Relief Society president, and again, we had a bunch of awesome youth in the ward, and although I didn't work with them very closely too often, I would from time to time hear them whispering, you know, "Who is she? Who are you? You know, she's different." And so as those youth have gotten older and they're now adults now, I've asked them about, you know, what they were thinking in those years back then. And most of the times they say, "Well, you were just an anomaly to us. You know, we physically saw you every Sunday, but you didn't exist in our world." And so I asked them what that meant, and you know, they said, "Well, we weren't used to seeing women like you. You know, we're used to seeing women who, you know, by the time they were 18, 25 definitely at least had one child, whether they were married or not. They were not used to seeing someone who was single, who had a steady job, who someone had a plan for what they wanted to do in life. And so it was very eye-opening to me to hear them say that although they physically saw me, I didn't exist to them. And I think that is one of the things that we need to change for not just Black and brown youth, but all youth. They need to know that there are leaders out there who do exist to them. They need to know that there are leaders out there who see through the same lens that they are seeing, that they're seeing through and that they are experiencing. And I think to answer one of the big questions of this session is how do we do that and how do we keep Saints active? During the time I was Lead Society president, and again, it was a very active time. Church for me usually lasted 7 hours every Sunday with all the meetings and everything. Dalyn knows this. He was oftentimes there. So one of the things that I would often get asked, being the only Black person in the room, is why are people like this? Why are they doing these things? You know, why aren't they making the same choices that Sarah Jane would be making? And so there were often a lot of conversations of me explaining about culture and how the Black inner city culture is different, but different not meaning bad or wrong, and not meaning it needs to be changed, but just different. And that as the leadership, it needed to be approached and seen through a different set of eyes. And I think one of the big issues we had for a long time in my ward was that all of our bishops were men who were called to serve as bishop, but they were coming from wards that were deep in the suburbs and they had no connection to the city. They didn't live in the city, they didn't work in the city, they knew nothing of the city, knew nothing of the membership. And so so the lens that they were seeing through, the lens that they would see the problems that our ward members were having were vastly different, and it meant that they didn't quite understand why people were making the choices they did or why different things were happening to the members and why quote-unquote life wasn't getting better although they had the gospel. And so one of the things that if I could implore to higher leadership in the church is to have people learn to see through different lenses and know that your lens is not the only lens out there.
All right. I would like to thank our panelists. We've done an interesting thing, and I haven't been given any real direct directions, so we'll see if somebody is running up here to correct me or not. I let the clock run to let everybody have their say, which has put us actually right at time for the end of our session. So I don't know if we have to get out of the room real fast or not.
You can go 15 minutes for question and answers.
So the first thing I'll do, is there anyone on the panel from anything that anyone else has said that's just burning them up and they got to get out? Okay, so with that in mind, now with the last session in mind, I'm going to reiterate the rules and state that we will in fact enforce them this time. Saying, if you have a question, raise your hand and they will bring a microphone to you. I am not directing where the microphones go. I'm just moderating that way. But please ask a question. It's not a time to make a long statement or a sermon. After you make your clear statement.
Sorry, I've been told we have 5 minutes, not 15. Sorry.
It's a big difference. So they have to be quick, concise questions. So we probably have time for two, maybe three, depending on how long-winded our answers are. Go.
You know, honestly, I don't know. I guess that would be a mission president, MTC, higher level sort of a question. But
the article didn't change anything, huh? Mm-hmm. Go ahead.
You know, but
were I a mission president, which I am not,
yeah.
I would train the missionaries. And one thing you have to realize with mission presidents is church gospel and doctrine and all those things are not normally their biggest constraint. It's 18-year-olds. Right. So when you understand a lot of what they're doing is our management decisions, as a manager of, and there is a gospel layer on top of that, I would instruct them to teach that essay and that essay. The editorializing past that, and I would say for most people, no matter where in the church they come from, is editorializing. Yes. Meaning the church has said in that statement, here is what we know, here is what we say. Anytime anybody says anything beyond that or above that, they are coming up with that, not the church. So people can have a lot of personal discussions, but those are not the same as authoritative gospel discussions.
Yeah, you know, I don't know what, you know, I can tell you what I do in my home and my family. I have two boys, of course, African-American. We talk about those issues. So we have gospel discussion, race issues and discussions and issues and challenges. And I just, so we do that. My daughter, before she went to Cape Verde, which is predominantly black, is different. But I told her one of the greatest challenges that she's going to face when she gets there is that they're going to think she's African and she's not. And so she faced that challenge and had to deal with that. But we do have those live discussions in my home. And we do talk to our young men in our stake. We have those discussions. And hopefully that prepares them a little bit better to be missionaries to address those issues. I don't want to put her on a spot, but I think you serve with President Holsafel. Do you want to share what he kind of shared with you about that? I'm sorry. I know we just shared briefly about it. If you don't. President Holsafel was the mission president that just left the Alabama-Birmingham mission. He discussed those issues. President Hanks, I know, I meet with him and talk to him often. He discussed these issues with his missionaries because they are serving in inner city black communities, and these questions and comments come up, and so missionaries have to be well trained. So I know from those two perspectives, and that's just a sample of two, President Holsafel and President Hanks, and I don't know if you want to talk to President Hosoffel's situation if you want, but feel free if you want to.
Can you turn around, please? Yeah, and turn the mic up.
Is it on?
Yeah.
Okay. So I guess like to speak to what he's talking about. A couple of weeks ago, I was on BYU campus for a little like conference for women in academia, and I stopped into President Holtzoff's office. He was my mission president for 4 months before I went to Brazil to serve the rest of my mission. And I asked him, how does he respond to race in the priesthood? How does he teach it to BYU students? Because I'm going to teach it in my ward in Sunday school, and I wanted to get his perspective because he's a white male BYU religion professor. And he told me, he's like, I can only speak from my experience as a white male, and I can only tell you what it's like for me and what I experienced, and I need to give space to other people to talk about it, white, black, any color, so that they can express how they feel, because ancient history isn't just ancient history, it's present history. And we need to be able to talk about it so that we can actually be able to help people heal from that, because it's very painful for everybody. It's not just like black pain or white pain, like everybody hurts from it, and we don't want to talk about it because it hurts. And so he's like, when I create a safe space, we're better able to have those conversations and just be real. It's uncomfortable, it hurts, but you still have to talk about it. And he told me about President Johnson's here's experiences and how they helped him as a mission president to be able to better serve these black people in the inner city in Alabama, and which I think is really, really important to just know it's gonna be uncomfortable and it's gonna be painful, but it's a necessary conversation to have as a missionary, as a member missionary. Everybody in the church and outside of the church needs to be able to talk about it.
So just an sample of two, right? With President Hosafo and my experience interaction with him, as well as President Hanks and what they're doing with the missionaries in Alabama Birmingham mission. So I can't speak what's happening in MTC or in other places, but I could speak to those experiences that it is on at least the two mission presidents that served in serving in our area, and how they're doing with the missionaries in our area and the impact that they're having on those missionaries as they go out and teach our brothers and sisters.
Are we out of time, Paul?
One last question.
Is the microphone out there somewhere?
Yeah, I've got it right here.
There you go.
So I think we're all kind of on the same page here with our train of thought. And before I ask my question, I just wanted to say thank you to all of you that came up out to the panel and everyone that has come previously. I think there's a lot of spiritual uplifting that has come for many of us. And I think there's also a lot of people that are getting some type of thought process beginning in their heads and going forward. But my question is, I believe it applies to all four of you, but more specifically to Bishop and Stake President. We've talked about missionaries. Huh? Oh, both Stake Presidents, please excuse me.
I was gonna hit you with that, but you go ahead.
Yeah, see, there needs to be an edited, new, updated cut of the film, see? No. In all seriousness, though, both of you are actively, due to your calling, actively engaged in one way or another with, like, ward mission councils or stake mission councils. So my question is to you, when you are actively engaged in real missionary moments, and I mean real as in speaking with missionaries, what are you in your positions doing to make sure that those missionaries that are coming from all over the United States and some of them coming from other countries, maybe Tonga or Samoa, to make sure that they actually know the information that we've all been discussing today so that they don't get hit with that type of question that Dalyn got, and then that they don't give a question or respond in a way that isn't quote unquote LDS approved. And I ask that because me and my wife, we're actively engaged. Every single time we get new missionaries that come into our ward, we are always pulling them aside and we're asking them these questions. And then we're inviting them to our house and this is an active conversation in our home.
You wanna take it first?
Is it Michael? Yes. Oh, can you guys hear me? Okay, sorry. I would say I think there's certainly a lot more that needs to be done in that area of, discussing these very specific questions with the missionaries. I think as I think about ward councils, which missionaries often participate in our ward councils, I've often talked about challenges of generational poverty. Now, this is sort of a deviation somewhat from your question, but this is something that comes up, as it relates to, I guess I'm thinking more from a retention perspective. Why, members being baptized and they're not coming to church, we've even had one of the ward council members even respond and say, well, I'm really getting sick and tired of this. Well, how come, members are coming into the church, we're always being asked to provide transportation, as Dalyn alluded to, this 10-member situation where you have only those strong members who are being asked to provide assistance. And we've gotten into conversations about the nature of generational poverty, the nature of the challenges that people are confronted with, so that deeper understanding can happen. But as it relates to missionaries, I think there's more that I can do, that we can do in my stake to more directly address that question.
Yeah, there's always more we can do. I talk with the mission presidents directly, probably a little bit more than directly with the missionaries, but I do get asked probably, and I don't want to overstate it, because it's where we live, right? And so there's African-American culture that they teach, and so I do go out with the missionaries, and that question comes up, and I go with them on discussions, and I share my story, my testimony, and give people the opportunity to see what they're gonna do and exercise their own agency to develop a relationship. But there's definitely more we can do. I do work more directly with the mission president because they have the keys over the missionaries, and so it's their responsibility to teach them, not mine. My responsibility definitely deals with the ward council, so we do talk about those issues more in that setting and training and how to deal with that and those issues that come up. And I was gonna leave you to my my final thought with this as well, too. What we also talk about, though, is there's a difference between surviving and prospering. And so what we try to help our members, we want them to prosper. The Lord wants them to prosper, not just survive. And so we talk about the difference in an African-American community. We are survivors. Right, my mother is a survivor, right? A single mom of five, she's a survivor. My father, eighth grade education, growing up in Arkansas, he's a survivor, and I love what I've learned from them. Now let's take it to the next level. How can we also prosper? And so that's kind of the direction we try to go in with that, with this this dilemma that we face.
I want to thank all the panelists again for their participation and all of you who came from near and very far for your attendance here. It's very meaningful. And the one thing that I know that Paul and I really hoped for when we were conceptualizing this whole thing is that it wouldn't be just a time for those of us who saw something and self-selected in. Like, this is something that we're already interested in. Let's get together with people who think like us and discuss some stuff that we're interested in. Which is awesome to do. That's why grad school was the funnest time of my life, right? You find your same brand of nerd and hang out with them for a while, right? But we really hope that that's not what this would be ultimately, that this would be a time for us to come and formulate some ideas, initiate and model ways to start discussions that might not leave us completely satisfied, but show us that they can be had so that we can then go out and start having those discussions with others, so that we can have something recorded that others could then be shown, that can then be perpetuated, right? We don't want this to be, at the end of the day, a time where we all came and talked to each other. All of this should be for some action, for some good to happen, because that's the whole purpose of the organization of Christ Church on Earth.
Let's give the panel a last round of applause. I hate to be the enforcer, but they do need to lock up the building, so we are being kicked out. I know everyone wants to keep talking. Please talk outside.